really appreciate the turnout again, and we've got a really good cross section of diamond people and other geologists in the audience. So just by way of background, can you hear me now?
Okay, so
Jim doesn't need a lot of introduction. He started off his career as a field officer with De Beers, and then tells us he saw the light. He went back to university. He graduated again at Rhodes, another of the Rhodes gang. And he's then spent a long and distinguished career in this business. He's been in exploration and had successes in the exploration side of the sector. And then importantly, he's been able to take deposits and actually turn them into mines and mine things economically. And if you look at the number of kimberlites out there in the big wide world, I mean, or kimberlites and related rocks, probably over 8,000, there are very few that have actually been turned to account economically. And Jim's one of the persons that has done that. And most of all, he's done it with kimberlite fishers. And he's going to talk to us about that today. So thanks, Jim. Thanks for making the time and putting all the effort into preparation. And we look forward to your presentation. Go for it.
Right. Thanks a lot, John, and good morning, fellow Overberg geoscientist participants this morning. It's a pleasure for me to be able to speak to you and do a presentation. John got hold of me a couple of months back and asked me to put something together, and we eventually decided on the title that has been advertised, The Secrets of Successful Fisher Diamond Mining. And since that time, I've spent a lot of time trying to put something together to pass on the information. I have been helped to a large extent by Henny, who's our moderator there, and he's been beating me on how to use this instrument in front of me for Zoom presentations. And then our geologist on the mine, Jan Rust, he's been with me for about 18 months now. Jan has helped a tremendous amount in putting together this presentation, and also he's going to help me drive this machine today in case something goes wrong. Please don't blame me, you can blame Jan. So the title, as I said, is Secrets of Successful Fisher Diamond Mining. I presume you all know that fishers stand, that pipes and blows stand on fisher systems, and that the fishers are the feeders of the pipes that we all chase around and look after. But the fishers beneath them are very lucrative operations if you manage them correctly. The title again, Secrets of Successful Fisher Diamond Mining. I just put this out in the beginning. There's no secrets. There's a situation. The thing has a contained revenue, and it is under the ground, and you've got to do it correctly. If you don't do it correctly, it will drag you down. So you must be careful. Just apply all the principles that you should be applying, and then it'll work very well. So again, no secrets, just apply yourself. So we go, where are these fisher mines in South Africa? There's a host of fisher mines, many of them. A lot have been used by unscrupulous dealers who enrich themselves by taking other people's money. And then you have a thing that lands up in a failure. However, the ones that we see on the screen are the ones that have made it to some extent or another. I will start on the bottom with the Star Mine. That was discovered in the early 50s, and it made it down to a depth of about 450 meters and has eventually ground into halt, and it's been closed down. You have the Ardo and Duplessis in the Kimberley area. That has made it down to about 400 meters. It was discovered in the 60s, and below 400 meters, it has faulted. Close to that, on the Kaap Plateau, you've got the Bobbejaan fissure, and that one has made it down to 750 meters. That is quite a significant depth. The Belsbank, 2.5 kilometers to the west of that, that made it down to 400 meters. And those two mines produce a fabulous parcel of diamonds. And then the last one on here is Helam Mine. Helam Mine has been going for about 85 years now. It was discovered in the early 30s. And it has never closed down. It had a brief period of care and maintenance, but we're trying to revive it again. The simple thing about these fissure mines that you see here, at one stage or another in their lives, they were money spinners. Normally it was when they were closer to surface, and then everyone says, no, well, it got deeper and more difficult and whatever. I can tell you this, that getting deeper does not really enhance the difficulty factor more. When you're underground, you're underground. You're one level or two level or 20 level, you're underground, and you've got to play by the rules. And you have got to adapt to the changes that are going on about you. If you don't adapt and don't adapt correctly, well, your mine is going to close down. So I'm going to run through some of the characteristics and things of these fissure mines. I'll put out those things, and then I'll try to summarize what we're trying to do at Helam. The facts on these fissure mines, they've only been mined successfully in South Africa. Nowhere else in the world has a fissure mine been successfully mined. There are a lot of fissures in Sierra Leone, but yet none of those have made it. And South Africa remains the only place where they've been successfully mined. They are always low tonnage operations, and they have a comfort zone. Don't think you can double up your tons or quadruple your tons easily, because as I said, they have a comfort zone. You live within that comfort zone, everything works well. You try to push the envelope, it will knock you down. They have always been labor intensive, and this is probably the reason why they were successful in South Africa. But then you look at Sierra Leone, it was the same kind of labor regime. They just did not work there. So they are labor intensive. And historically, they produced about 2% of South Africa diamonds. When I say historically, I'm talking about the heyday when they had the Kimberley pool going. You had the Kimberley mines going. You had the Finch mine going. And this is before the days of Venetia. And these mines between Dan Carl, Belsbank, Bobbejaan, Ardo, Du Plessis, Star, and Helam produced about 300,000 carats per annum. So that is the situation. You had these deposits that produced a lot of diamonds. And the situation is currently you have none. And these things have one by one, they've all fallen by the road. Next is they, historically, they employed about 15% of South Africa's kimberlite workforce. Today, they employ virtually none because of the changed circumstances, and the people have not been able to adjust to the changes in circumstances. Right, as an example of a fissure intrusion, this is the Belsbank deposit. You can clearly see there, you can go to the Belsbank area and you've got these cracks running all over the surface, and that is what they look like. And this is a blow that is standing on the dike. And I will be coming back to this slide later on in more detail. This is another example of a blow and a dike. You can see the dike down there. You can't really see it here. That's the way the trace is. But this is the Phoenix pipe, or the Phoenix blow on the Star mine. So that gives you an idea of what they look like. And now we go into the characteristics of these economically mined fishes. They always intrude as a host of spheroidal shaped sheets. And these sheets were described by John Gurney and Melissa Kirkley. And John, he's been into every diamond mine in the country, probably in the world as well. And they describe these things with having had a look at a lot of the fissure mines. And so you have these discoidal shaped intrusions, and somehow these intrusions all make it through to surface or close to surface. They do not necessarily go through to surface. The average width of these things where they've been successfully mined sits at about 70 centimeters. Now, they might thin out on the edges down to 30, 20 and things like that, but there they don't get mined. And in the middle, they maybe get up to 80 or 90 centimeters. That comes with its own difficulties, but overall, they seem to average around about 70 centimeters in thickness. The strike length of these discoidal sections is variable, and they can get up to 500 meters in length. And when you have it in 500 meters length, depending on the mining method you're doing, it's very nice. But if they are shorter strike lengths, then it's problematic because you've got to re-establish stopes every time it steps. The strike length of the whole system can get up to 15 kilometers. I've seen examples like that. One I quoted is the Star Dyke Swarm. They extend from a farm called Stinney's Wrist in the west, where people have tried to mine them unsuccessfully, to the Driekop mine to the east of Star. That's a total distance in excess of 15 kilometers. So there's a lot of the stuff around, and they all follow this N echelon and discoidal intrusion shape. The situation with these things, they occur in dominantly N echelon lenses. And you can see they have horizontal N echelon lenses. Get a step, goes across there, get a step, goes there, get a step, goes there. They also do that vertically. There they are, they step, come down, there they are, and they come down. So it's not one massive, long, intrusive sheet. It's a whole lot of discoidal shaped sheets that have tried to make it through to surface. And you have to look at how that happens. What I've said, this is facilitated by what I've referred to as continuity stringers. And there you can see I marked them there. They are horizontal, and you also get them vertically. You see this is a schematic of these things. So you'll have vertically and you'll have them horizontally. In essence, you'll have a zone there where you have this continuity stringer. Now, I use the word continuity for the reason that this kimberlite intrusion has enough power, i.e. pressure, behind it to move the Earth's crust 70 centimeters apart. It's not a crust that has been filled up, not a crack that has been filled up by magma that rolled into it. It is magma that has been pushed up from the bottom and has pushed the Earth's surface 70 centimeters apart. And you can imagine the immense amount of pressure that must be around to able to do something like that. So these things I refer to as continuity stringers, that is to maintain the hydrostatic pressure of the fissure system that is busy intruding. So that's what you see in the schematics of it. This is in reality, you can see this is one where you have a continuity fissure there. That was the feeder, and it turns into nothing down there. There's nothing there, and dies out over, it sends a little stringer up there. That sits as a blob. But what that is, it's a continuity from this fissure that you'll have below you here to that fissure that you'll have above you there. So I refer to these as continuity stringers. And what happens is that in these areas where you've got these continuity stringers, you have minimal overlap of the fissure itself, but you do have a continuity stringer in that zone. The host rock in this locality is severely broken. And don't even try to mine it because the gods don't want you to get it and it'll just come down above your head. So this continuity area is a very broken up area and you should try to avoid it. If you've got a drive, a horizontal drive that is going through there, you're reasonably okay. If you've got a horizontal drive that is going through here, you're going to have difficulty. You're going to have difficulty. It's going to cost you more support. So here is an example. The previous one we saw just now in wider view, you can see it. There's the continuity stringer. It goes into calcite veining, and that's where it goes there. And there, and this ground around it is terribly These are horizontally bedded Silverton gritty shales, and you can see no evidence of the bedding there. It's all gone. It's been broken. So try to avoid those areas in your work. All right. So now a simple example of an Eslon intrusion. Again, this is the Star Mine at Tennyson. And as I said to you, this extends way out to the west to a place called Stinney's Wrist. And this is the reason Star exists is that you have a Karoo dolerite sill. And that sill for the first two or three levels near surface is very good mining. And that sill is a dipping sill, and by the time you get to Wynandsfontein, it is down at 10 level. So Wynandsfontein, this area here is in the sill. This area above it here is in the Karoo shales. So Karoo shales, not a good host, both for intrusion and for mining purposes. And you can see that where you're in the dolerite, it's a good host. The N echelon, that's the Kluwer, the Micaceous, the Burns, and then a step to the East Star, and then a step to the Wynandsfontein. Now, the interesting thing, that is the horizontal N echelon. You want the vertical N echelon. East Star goes down very nicely until about six level, and six level, it disappears. There's no mining here. It steps about 80 meters back, and between 8 and 10 level, East Star is a very robust fissure. It's mined over there, and then it steps back to the north again. So you've got both your horizontal N echelon and your vertical N echelon. And that's an example of how this thing works its way up to surface. So you must know that there are more than one type of kimberlite can be present within all these systems. And like I just mentioned there, the Burns and East Star are, to my mind, the same fissure. The Micaceous and the Kluwer are different. And then the Wynandsfontein is a totally different one. It's got a totally different set of indicator minerals. And they are not all the same. And then running parallel to those fissures, about 60, 80 meters to the north of them, is a totally barren fissure. And so you've got to know which are the correct ones, what you are mining, and be careful that you mine the correct things. Here's an example of multiple intrusion. This is at Helam on the third lease. You can see there, there's little stringers put into the sidewall of a earlier fissure intrusion, and you can see that earlier fissure intrusion has been wiped away. It's been wiped away by successive pulses of magma intrusion. And on this one, it's actually anyone who knows these kimberlites, you can see there are no mantle xenocrysts. So this fissure doesn't have diamonds. And so you've got to know your fissures, and also you've got to then know all the other aspects that make mining them a successful place. Right, so now we're going to go to, that was the academics, or some of the academics of the fissures. We're going to go to the mining methods. As simple things, these ore bodies do not readily lend themselves to bulk mining methods. If you're going to try and make it a bulk mine, you are going to probably fail. And I think one classic example, although it's not a fissure, everyone is aware of it by this time of the day, is the Snap Lake deposit in Canada. That is it's an inclined sheet, but it's inclined sheet intruding the same way that fissure deposits do. And if you try to ramp it up, you're going to run into difficulties. So you have to keep your development ahead of your stope faces. And this is merely because the stope is at some stage is going to pull a trick on you. And so if you're going to be mining four stopes to produce your 400 tons, make sure you've got five or six stopes available. So that gives you time to recover while you're moving to the next lens, or you're moving to the next lens further down. Always keep more face than is necessary. That's not good accounting philosophy. Accountants will tell you, you can't spend money and not get a return for it. Sometimes you've got to be able to spend money so that you are sure that you are going to have a return on it. So this is what I say, try to maintain more stope face than you actually need. And this is the big, big killer in fissure mines, is the dilution by waste. And we'll get into that in more detail as I go on. This is an example, a snapshot from a fissure diamond mine. The interesting to note here, this is your percentage of fissure. So if you have a fissure that is 50 centimeters wide, you will land up with, without any problem, you will land up with 100% dilution, and you will land up with a 1 meter wide stope. That is norm for these fissures, but this is a survey measurement, and it's a measurement when the fissure is opened. It's not the measurement of the fissure at the end of the day when you finished mining it. At the end of the day when you finished mining it, you land up with this tons per centare hoisted, and or per meter cube. A centare is 1 meter square in the plane of the fissure. And if you take a normal 65 centimeter wide fissure, and you multiply that by the density, you'll have approximately 1.1 tons of kimberlite that deliver the diamonds. And this tons per centare hoisted shows you the amount of dilution you have. And this is what is the big killer. As an example, helium has a recoverable grade of 300 carats per 100 ton in clean fissure. And at the end of the day, helium lands up with a recovered grade of around about 73. And you land up with over 300% dilution of your fissure by waste. And that is a result of mining method, also bad mining practices and bad decisions. The similar situation exists with the Bobbejaan Dyke down in Belsbank, where you have an in-situ recoverable grade of around just over 70, and you battle to get 20 carats per 100 ton out of it. When they mined Bobbejaan as an underhand operation, they managed to achieve 38 to 40 carats per 100 ton. And the same situation for Star, where you have an in-situ recoverable grade of about 77, It is an underhand mine, and you get a grade there of, if you do everything well, you get 35. So your waste dilution, you've got to look after that all the time. So this is an example now of waste dilution. We're going back to that shot I showed you in the beginning, and this is at Bell's Bank, and you'll see there is your fissure in the middle, and there is your parallel cleavage with that waste that always comes away. And if you look a little bit further, you can see there's another pillar, and you can see there's your parallel cleavage. If you look inside here, you can see there's your parallel cleavage, there's your parallel cleavage there. It is always there, it doesn't go away. If you look at this picture a little bit more carefully, I've drawn a couple of lines there. You can see this, you can extend them down. You can see this is the parallel cleavage that came along with the intrusion of this kimberlite pushing the Earth's surface apart by 70 odd centimeters. So if you take a look at this thing and remember what I was saying about waste dilution, here you already have 100% dilution. And you take this little arrow and you go up with it and you see what has happened to that stone. And you look inside there on this side where you can't really see them, but you can imagine, you can almost imagine those things are there. You can see there, your parallel cleavage is there. There it is. And that falls away. And this is what causes your waste dilution. And so if you mine it well, you're going to get 100% dilution without a doubt. And then if you now start disregarding all the things you have to do, you are going to get more waste into your system. So we take the mining methods. Traditionally, there have been two mining methods. One is underhand. That is when the ore that you're working on is beneath you. You stand on top of it and you drill into it. And the other one is commonly known as shrinkage. It's overhand. Overhand refers to the ore that you're working on is above you and you have to work underneath it. So those are the two methods, and they have their special applications and drawbacks and advantages. I'm going to go through them now, and we'll compare one to the other as we're going on. And we start always with overhand on the left there. And overhand is more cost-effective and used for larger tonnages in fisher mines. Underhand is less cost-effective, and it is used for smaller tonnages. It has reduced support needed, and the underhand requires massive support. I'll just elaborate on that massive support. It's not only the cost of the timber, it's the cost of inserting that support as well that really is the killer in that one. We go to the overhand, it is less labor intensive. And we go to the underhand, it's very labor intensive for that exact reason I've just been explaining over there. You have more dilution in your run of mine, so you can have a lower grade, and it's a much cleaner run of mine, and you're going to have a higher grade. It can be used for poorer sidewall conditions, and that is merely the fact that your muck pile supports your sidewall until you are finished mining it, and you finished mining it when your dilution starts killing you. And this one, this needs good sidewall conditions, otherwise you can't do it. We continue with those. The overhand is suited to more continuous lenses, and this is better for more erratic lenses. Give you an example, Star, the lenses are very short-lived, and you have to restart a stope every now and then, and this is why the underhand is more used at Star. 60% of your ore is locked up for several months. That's the muck pile that you're working on, and with the underhand, the ore is immediately available. So with the overhand, your mining today comes out over a period of 6 months. Gives an immense amount of time for that parallel cleavage to slough away and come into your ore. With the underhand, what you mine today goes to the plant tomorrow, And the shrinkage there leads to massive waste dilution, whereas you have reduced waste dilution in your underhand. You have a dirty survey measurement and you have a clean survey measurement. And you have a flexible grade control and a rigid grade control. This dirty survey measurement is it's a thing you that plagues mines, because you never know exactly how many centaurs have been mined, because guys can't get into stopes, and I'll show you why just now. So let us move into this is a schematic of any fisher mine, where you have your fisher and your stringer, and you put in your shaft, you put in your crosscut, your zero crosscut, then you start doing your tunnel development, and you start putting in your crosscuts. That's a schematic for any mine, it's the same. You have, as you get deeper, your distance to fissure must increase, and your distance between crosscuts has to increase. This is to maintain the stability of your pillar between the crosscuts. Otherwise, these things start to become crushed. So you got to do, but as you get deeper, that just gets a little bit more, but you can adjust for that. What I said earlier, people haven't adjusted to the conditions. So they've rigidly stayed by that. Then you land up with crushed tunnels, footwall heave, all kinds of funny things happening. So that was the schematic of it, and this is what really happens. This is an example on John Shaft 20 level. The world knows that Helium has a main fissure, a changehouse fissure of low grade, not mineable, and a male fissure that is barren. But in reality, Helium has two main fissures. And it's never really been reported on, but it's got two main fissures, and they actually intrude into the same locality, but there is a difference in time of intrusion. And that distance in time has affected your stress measurements. And if you change the stresses, your ellipsoid varies slightly, and the cleavage direction varies slightly. So you can just work it out that this thing has intruded around the same couple of million years, but not on at the same time. So you take the main fissure, and what I'm going to do now is just to demonstrate the business I talked about of continuity fissure. This is the south fissure. It sends a spur out there, but it carries on, carries on, carries on, carries on, and it goes all, you carry on all the way there. It's a 65, 70 centimeter wide fissure. You have the north fissure, also a 65, 70 centimeter fissure, and it goes along, and then it now finds it can't get itself through in this locality properly. So it starts a continuity stringer that comes through there and dies. It's gone over here. So that's a continuity one. And this fissure here dies. And this one here, it starts up here. So this fissure that you see here had a continuity fissure there and there, and then it continues over there. So it stepped a distance of, in this instance, round about 40 meters. And in that distance of 40 meters, this fissure here, where it's starting up on its new leg, is never going to be 70 centimeters wide. And this one is never going to be 70 centimeters wide, because the system had enough pressure to push the Earth's crust apart by 70 centimeters. It didn't have enough pressure to push it apart by 1.4 meters. So this one is always round about half. That one's about half of the width that the main fissure will do. These two fissures here, they also come together and they do horizontal Cook sister rolls. If you understand what I mean, they go over one another and they come back, and they also do that vertically. And what happens then is you land up with a wide fissure of 1.2 meters wide, but you also have to contend with a lot more waste. So it's nice having a wide fissure, but it comes with a lot of waste problems. We carry on, and this is now actually mining them. For the underhand, this is now in section. You put in your zero crosscut, and there you go up with a raise. You put a raise through to the next level, and that'll take you 2 to 3 months to get that raise through, because it's done by handheld drills. And this just carries on a monthly basis, and your ore comes out here at the bottom. There you have top entrance there. And what happens with this, that every 4 meters in the stope, by legal requirement, you have to have a row of mat packs together with gum planks that cover you. So the people that are working beneath this are covered from rocks falling from above. So when you're finished, this is an open space that has a hell of a lot of timber in it. So one, it costs you a lot of money to buy the timber. It costs you a lot of money to put the timber in place. And it also becomes a massive fire hazard. So you've really got to be watch out, because what happens, miners tend to hang their igniter cord over poles, and you can very easily start a fire underground. For an underhand stope, this is an example of the mat packs that you have to put in. And you can see there's a lot of support going into it. The sidewall conditions are very good, so you can put the support in and it stays there. You have, as a further example, you can see the amount of timber that you look anywhere in this thing, all you're doing is you're seeing timber. And you have to put that timber in. That there is a wedge. In the gold mines, they have fancy acro props and things that you blast up with air. In the fissure mines, these things are put in place, held in place, and then you put a wedge in, and that's wedged in place with a 14-pound hammer, and you've got several of those around. But what I also said, you have to have good stope conditions, sidewall conditions. And you can see it starting to develop in this one already. When this mat pack was put in, this sidewall was in this position here. In the time that we've met, this has been mined for several months, this sidewall has already fallen back 6 or 7 inches. And if this continues, you have a sidewall with broken ground here and broken ground on that side, and eventually this whole thing collapses down on the people. So these underhand can only be used if you have stable ground sidewall. Now we move to the overhand, and just imagine for the underhand, I showed a raise that goes through, and what should then happen, you put a raise up, it takes you about 2 to 3 months to put that raise through, but you get to a situation, and this I can vouch for you at Helium, we encountered this, at Bobbejaan we encountered this, and that the fissure does not allow you to put a raise through. It comes down around your ears before you can get halfway up. And so what happens then is you should have a raise that goes through there. It is overhand, your stope should advance in that direction because you're working with your ore above you. You drill into that and you blast it. So what happens, I'm going to show you in the next slide, this raise does not go in there, that stope doesn't march in that direction, but actually lands up marching in that direction. So I'll show you what happens in reality. Yeah, you got a situation where guys started trying to put up a raise, they couldn't get up. So you come in with the next crosscut and the next crosscut, and they start lifting that. And then they come into the next crosscut and they start lifting that a bit further. And then they come the next crosscut, they can't get in. So you come in the next crosscut and they get in there like that. This is taboo. You should not have a thing like that. So you have a lot of difficulty in mining these things, and you have to be very sharp how to do it. So what happens normally here is they lift the stope like that, and eventually you land up with the stope that is now moving in that direction, as opposed to a stope that should have been moving in that direction. So it's now moving in that direction. And then just why this slide is up is that you can see every one of these lines here that is dotted means that the surveyor did not get in to be able to measure the fissure width and the stope width. So yeah, there one, all these months you can see there he didn't get in. At the end of the day, he didn't get in. And it's given that it has fallen through to the next level. So with the overhand mining, you are supposed to have top entry. You're supposed to blast here every day, come in from the top, make safe, and then blast the next day. So I'm gonna go on to the next one. And what happens now, I've explained to you how this happens, where you should be advancing in that direction, your stope, because of the difficulties, you're actually advancing in that direction. So what now happens is you should have top entrance there, but you don't have top entrance. So the guys come in from the bottom and they've blasted this. After the end of every blast, this expansion cavity, which is about 2 meters, is filled up with fissure and waste. You come in the morning, they draw it down, and then they make it safe and they support it, but all done from the bottom up. So the net result here is you don't have a top entry. If you don't have a top entry, you don't have ventilation. Your ventilation should come in here, go out the top. So you don't have ventilation, you have a lot of dust. You also overheat and the guys get hot. And there are all kinds of things that go wrong with this method, and you've got to be very careful about it. So what happens in this area here, where you've drilled every day, you get relatively clean ore, and this, as your muck pile gets older over a 6-month period, you get more and more waste sloughing away, and your waste that you draw down from here being massively diluted and this being relatively clean. So what happens is the directors shout at the mine manager, that what's happening to my grade, what's happening to my carats. The mine manager shouts at the mine captain. The mine captain shouts at the shift boss. The shift boss has a go at the miners and then everyone. So what they do is they go, there is a mountain of very dilute ore lying here. They go and they pull the hell out of this. You get your tons, but you don't get your grade. So you have to fight again about that all the time. So that gives you an example of what happens in the shrinkage mining. And this is, in essence, there is the fissure. That piece there is the fissure. There is your parallel cleavage that you always have with it. And this will give you your 100% dilution. But if you have a look at this stope, you can see the cleavages there. You can see those cleavages. And before too long, this thing gives you 200% dilution and then 300% dilution. And so your contained revenue that you're moving around the mine drops all the time. And you just got to control your waste dilution. So to give you an example of what you saw there now, if you go to a fissure mine and you go and visit it, you'll see that's the new stockpile. It looks pretty. And looks like it's a whole lot of fissure. And there's an old saying in the base metal game that a halfpenny worth of copper stains a mountain green. Well, a little bit of fissure stains a whole heap so that it looks pretty. And you look at that pile and you can see here's a pile that's been lying around for a couple of days. They're actively loading into the plant here now. But if you look there, you can see it. Oh, that doesn't look like fissure. And then you arrive there on a day when you've had a good rainstorm and you see what your ore pile looks like. It doesn't look too pretty. You can see the odd piece of fissures sticking around here and there. But by and large, this is waste. This is andesitic lava. This is an example from the Bourbillon fissure. And this stuff will still give you a grade of around about 20. And that is what you live on. And you've had a massively diluted ore that you're humping around the mine. So you've got to really be careful for that waste dilution. With that waste dilution, it moves through into the plant where you any fissure operation has to have a waste picker belt. And that waste picker belt will normally be a minimum of 10 bodies picking off the waste. And normally you do it around about 35. 35 millimeters is a reasonable size to take it at. And you can say that about 65% of your ore is sitting on top of this belt, and maybe 70% of that way. It doesn't all go off, because the minute you turn your back on this operation, a lot of waste goes through to the crusher. So you have to look after this. And what then happens, your minus 35, where you're not picking off any waste, is massively diluted. So you're feeding a massive amount of waste into your plant. And that waste has a further problem, is that it is difficult to comminute, it is hard on the crushers, and you get a buildup in recirculating load. So you've got to get rid of that recirculating load, and you've got to be imaginative with the cuts that you're using. Okay, so now, how do you make one of these mines work economically? And situation again, right in the beginning, I said that these mines that you saw on that picture of the craton, they are all, at some stage in of their lives, they have been very economically successful. And things have changed, whether it's your mining method, whether it's your depth of mining, whether it's your regulatory environment, whether it's your cost of electricity. There are all kinds of things that change. And you have got to react to all those to make that thing work. So with helium, we know we've got a very nice resource. We got a 1.5 million carat reserve and another more than 1.5 million carats in resource. And that is open-ended. So helium has got plenty of stuff and it contains the goodies. We know that the in-situ recoverable grade, I use that word recoverable because when you talk to geologists, they'll come up with resource. They can say, oh, but what about your fines? What about your plant losses? All helium star and Bourbillon, we did back calculations on the recoverable grade, i.e. taking into account your plant losses as well. So you have an in-situ recoverable grade of 294, I think it is, to be exact. Now, what you land up with the recoverable grade is entirely what you've done or done wrong in your mining method. So we know how we've mined helium, and we are looking at helium and we're adjusting to the new circumstance of regulations, mining authorities. You have to look after your ventilation, all that kind of stuff. We have looked at a method called on-level stope retreat. Now, on-level stope retreat is merely a front cave or a sub-level cave. In a big kimberlite or anywhere else, you've got your ore body, you do your development in your ore body, and then you retreat. So this is just, we're doing a sub-level cave on a fissure, and we've called it on-level stope retreat. So what happens with this? We are going to change the flat end development, will be increased to 2.5 meters. Historically, fissure mines have been 2.2 by 2 meter drives. And there's a lot of reasons I can explain to you why they're that. Included in, if you have a 2 by 2.2 and you take a because you now have a situation where we can accommodate load haul dumpers. And in recent years...
Jim, can I interrupt you for a moment? Just go back a few sentences. We lost your sound for a moment. Just repeat that, please.
Okay, with the start of the on-level stope retreat.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so we've introduced on-level stope retreat, which is basically a sub-level cave or a front cave where you do all your development into your ore body and then you retreat. And so we are doing that at Helium, and we're now also enlarging our drives to 2.5 meters square so that we can put load haul dumpers in. So you don't have to have people pushing hoppers around. Traditionally, you'd have 100 to 150 cross trammers pushing hoppers. Now you just put in two load haul dumpers. And so you adapt to the situation. TMM equipment has been available for a long time, but not narrow vein TMM in South Africa. In America, Mexico, Canada, you've had a narrow vein TMM for quite a long time, but it's never caught on in South Africa because never really been needed. So that is what we're doing here and how we're going to change it. We're changing the interlevel spacing from 35 to 25 meters. You recall that section I showed you with the overhand mining, where you think you're getting 35 meters, but you're not. You're getting a whole lot of dilution at the top. So you want to get all your ore. We're increasing the crosscut spacing to 20 meters and the distance to ore body to 12 meters. That will still keep us to getting somewhere in the region of 15 to 18 centares per flat end meter of development that we do. And for every flat end meter of development at Helium, if we have a grade of 65 carat per 100 ton, we will be opening up $3,000 worth of diamond. So you shouldn't be scared of doing that, because you can now move it mechanically. And you'll see further on what happens with these things. So while stoping, the fissure drives will serve a second outlet. So that's a technical thing. So what happens now, we maximize the financial return by reducing the waste dilution in the ore. We optimize the mining method. And we designed the layout to cater for generally weak kimberlite, because kimberlite is a MPI around about 40, 45. So it is a weak rock, and we massively decrease the labor requirement, remove all people from stopes. So now in the past, you had people in stopes, you didn't have second outlets. In this instance now, we won't have any people in the stopes. We're also going to remove all dust dilution as the new method allows for wet drilling. So just a quick run through of the schematic of that. You put in your shaft, you put in your zero crosscut and your tunnels, and you go onto the fissure. The next one is you put in your fissure drives either side of you. And so that becomes your entry point. And from this point, you start retreating. And you'll see we've changed the spacing to 12 meters and 20 meters. And then you go to the situation. So now the most difficult one in this, getting your on-level retreat going, is your break point. What you need to do is you then have to start breaking from the bottom. And you start with a short hole. 2 meters, then 4 meters, then 8 meters, then 10 meters. So this will take you 2 to 3 weeks to actually establish this. And there are drilling machines available, the old traditional S36 or the S20s. They can do 25 vertical meters, and you make your break point. Once you've got your break point, you now start retreating in your fissure drive that you've put in, and you drill one or two rounds, and you blast them and you pull them out over here. And what happens is that you put in a first, second, third level, and what you don't get out from this crosscut here, you get out from that crosscut. Every crosscut is staggered. So what you manage to leave behind, you get later stage, but not too much later. The beauty of this thing is what you've drilled and blasted in one day, you take to the plant tomorrow. So your waste dilution hopefully will be closer to 100% than 300%. So how do you reduce energy in the mining? This is a big thing. The above mining method reduces the compressed air requirement from 1,500 kVA to less than 500 kVA. Now, that is because the guy sitting in the stope, remember I told you he doesn't have any ventilation, so he's getting hot. He's got his rock drill there, and he always has an open compressed air pipe. Now, compressed air is the most expensive form of air. So he's using a massive amount of compressed air to cool himself. And this leads to a massive, you have to have a massive installation. That 1,500 will give you about 9,000 CFM. By doing this, we will only need not even 1,500 CFM. And that is a massive saving. You abandon hopper hoisting and hopper pushing around. You modify to skip hoisting. And if you do to those two and three above here, you have massive flexibility in your mining operation. Further, how do you reduce the consumption in the plant? You convert the comminution to AG milling. This removes the waste picker belt where you normally have to have 16 bodies. And at most, you will need 3 bodies to do a reef picker. So you put it in, it's a soft material, and you will land up with about a 70% attrition of the fissure, and you only have 30% of the fissure left, and you only pick off the core stuff. That you reduce your 3 crushers that you traditionally have to have, primary, secondary, and a tertiary, to maybe 1 and a mill. All depends on the cuts you use, your intelligent cuts, lead to an open circuit DMS, and you have a total plant complement reduces from 37 to 15. The execution above simplifies the whole plant and leads to a massive cost saving. This gives you an example of an AG mill, and we're actually making our own one. You don't have to buy them from Tyson Krupp. Once you know what you do, you can do them. So the adoption of the foregoing action results in the following for a 400 ton per day operation, a large reduction in workforce from 500 people to less than 200. Large improvement in mining safety, removal of all dust pollution, unlimited ore hoisting capacity, large reduction in power requirement for mining and plant. A very simple, low maintenance plant. So that is the story in the time I've been allotted. I thank you very much. And any questions, I hope to be able to answer them for you. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. That's fantastic. Okay, people can open their or unmute their Zooms and unmute their mics. Thanks, Jimmy. That was really good. And I'm glad that the communications worked like a bomb.
We've got John James wanting to ask something. John?
Yeah, I've worked on scoping studies and feasibilities as a geotechnical engineer for several fissure projects like this. I don't know whether any of them ever came to fruition, because from what you've just described, none of them did. Your modified method, which you're considering, is pretty much the one that we found in the scoping studies might be advisable. The one thing I would question is that with S36 machines, expecting to drill accurately without dilution over 25 meters is probably a little optimistic. I know that in the feasibilities we looked at, we consider that probably a 10 to 15 meter accurate drill with a 75 meter wide fissure length was as much as you could do without getting gross dilution from your blasting alone. The only other thing that we considered, it's quite similar to this, is to use the fissure drives themselves to extend out to the limits of each lens and then put the initial blasting, I always forget the name, gap, there on both sides and retreat using the fissure drive itself as your main mucking drive as well, which actually reduces your on that plane development requirements. But if you're going to be putting in levels every 15 meters instead of 25, obviously that would increase your development requirements, but it would be on reef development or on fissure development, which does again give you some income. Your comments.
Okay, John, thank you for those queries. I come closer to the picture here because I'm battling to hear what you're saying there, but I got it all. First of all, on the direction, you're totally correct. We've had several mining engineers and people who've been versed in the fissure mining for quite a long time. And the directional control on a 25 meter hole is difficult. So if you have a look at the start slide that I gave on making your cut, you will note that those are angled at around about 80 degrees. And that has the benefit that if you put in a hole at 80 degrees, if it deflects, it will normally deflect downward. So it will always deflect in one direction. So on the schematic we got here, the stope holes that you saw in the later sections are vertical. We've modified that. We haven't modified the sketch. And the stope 25-meter hole will always be drilled at 80 degrees. And that'll be because that hole, if it deflects, it normally deflects downwards and it'll always deflect in roughly the same direction. So we'll be drilling holes around about 50 centimeters apart. For a 25 meter stope, I need to do two holes that'll give me about 1.5 meters advance, and then I'm getting my 100 tons from that stope for that day. But you're correct in the deflection, very difficult, and the answer to that is always drill your holes at about 80 degrees, and then they will probably always deflect in the same direction. The second thing you asked about is using the fissure drive as your mucking stope. What we're also doing there, again, I said, you know, you just got to be clever about these things. And having people in the fissure drive has always been a problem because you got, when your fissure drive is about 10 meters long, 10, 12 meters long, you have to have two or three people in there mucking the stuff back. So what we've done is we've got engineers and clever guys here, and we have made a high torque reel where you will roll out a 3/4 meter wide heavy duty conveyor belt that'll have angle irons on it every 20, 30 centimeters. And before you take your blast, you roll that out. And the next morning when you come back to assist to get that stuff to your center pickup point for your LHD, you reel in that high torque reel. And that you've blasted the previous back to the crosscut. So you're correct, and we've got kind of answers for those.
Thank you. When I said a retreat drive, sorry, I'll try and speak closer. When I said a retreat drive on the fissure, I actually meant a full 2.5 meter wide drive. So you would be able to drive.
No, you can't.
LHDs in there, and obviously then you cut above that only to 75 meters. It does entail some support in the fissure drive. It's only a suggestion. Thanks for your answer,
John. You can't put with TMM Fisher drive-in, you destabilize your whole stope from the word go. You've always got your parallel cleavage. You have to put yourself out to try to not disturb the dominoes at the bottom. Because if you disturb them, that stope comes down about your ears. So you must try to preserve it. So you will put your fissure drive in, and your long hole drill will be done with not a handheld, it'll be an S36 on a bar, and you will be drilling your long hole in that 70 centimeter wide fissure.
Okay, thank you.
Right, Stuart Clegg, you had your hand up.
Yes, hello, Jim. Great to see you, and thanks for a great talk and the invitation. I have a comment, observation, question regarding the emplacement of the shears in that on echelon fashion. It seems as though they follow the cleavage in the Silverton, but then they jump across. So there must be some kind of shear stress involved as well. What are your comments on that, Jim? Thanks.
Well, I don't know if I got it properly, Stuart. Good to talk to you again. But the situation, the stress pattern that exists at the time will produce a preferred cleavage direction, and if you put pressure, it will crack in a preferred direction. And so it is just using the preferred stress direction that is there. And when it can't get out there anymore, it moves to another center point, 100 meters away, 200 meters away, to continue. It is breaking its way through in the path of least resistance, if I can try and put it like that.
Yes, thanks, Jim. That sums it up. Has anybody done any structural analyses on
that? No, no one's ever done that.
Okay, thanks.
Kurt, can you David videos?
David Apter?
Hello, Jim.
Jenny, can you lift the videos?
I don't know. The guys can turn on their own videos.
Go for it, Dave.
Can I start?
No, mine's not. Yeah, go.
Hi. Thanks, Jim. That was a...
Sorry. Go for it, Dave.
Okay. Thanks, Jim. That was fantastic. It was very nostalgic and reminded me of my days as a young boy visiting the coal steams at Bobby Yarn Mine. The question I have for you, you mentioned the overpressure required to push the earth apart some 70 centimeters, and I guess that would have been at some depth as well. Has anybody ever tried to calculate what those overpressures were?
Dave, no one has really tried to calculate anything like that. It's never been done. No, we just understand what it does, and we take it out, because the fissure, to a large extent, it plays its hand because they've all been mined from surface. So you've got them from surface, and it shows you where the steps are, where the initial on steps are, and those initial on steps continue down dip, and the thing there is, they plunge, certainly they plunge in either one direction or another, but they do that regularly.
Thanks, Jim.
Jim, James Campbell wants to know any views on the Newfield Resources plan to develop Tongo kimberlites in Sierra Leone.
What's that? Could you just...
James Campbell wants to know if there's any new views on the Newfield Resources plan to develop the Tongo kimberlites in Sierra Leone.
Oh, okay. Well. Look, they've gone by numerous names. They've morphed to various things. That's Carl and the guys. They have put out stuff. I haven't followed it very much. The problem with those fishers in Sierra Leone is that they are very narrow, and there are the same fishers sometimes as multiple ones, especially the Tonga area. So you're going to land up with a large percentage dilution by waste. That is something that might kill those operations, but you just waste. But I suppose if you look at the, if you go through to the platinum, where Teresa to the east of Rustenburg has, I think it's the MG that they're mining, they're taking all the veins of chromite that you have, and they are, instead of mining a half meter wide thing, they're mining a 40 meter wide thing. They're taking all the waste, they're crushing it, and so they don't have to worry about the mining method. They're doing open cast methods, so they skinning that cat in that way. The Sierra Leone ones, I don't know what you're going to do with it, because you're going to have to get rid of a lot of waste in your processing.
Thank you, John Bristow.
Yeah, Jim, I mean, it's our pet topic, and just looking at what you've done at Helm, it's very disconcerting to see the destruction, as you've seen recently, of the Star Mine and all these other small operations sitting idle. And in fact, I think you said the other day that Bellsbank's also been flooded. And that goes back to, you know, having a system and policies that make this business in sort of the small medium sector more favorable for development. I mean, do you want to share a little bit of your frustration having got this far?
John, well, I've got plenty of frustration. I don't think I should vent too many of them. Certainly the regulatory environment has become very severe, but you can understand that the guys want to have safety up front, and so you've got to play by the ball. And so this is why in the Helam, you know, the old mining method, which will not work today. You could have done it in the past. You can't do it today, but there's a clever way around doing it, and it actually benefits you more. So it's good that you get pressurized from that point of view. But having communication with the authorities on the licensing level and things like that is difficult. The exploration, I don't even want to do exploration, because before you even start doing something, kind of you go there and they say, okay, so where do you want to drill a hole? And you say, no, well, man, I want to do exploration before I can decide where I want to drill a hole. Okay, how many holes are you going to drill? Well, we don't know how much the anomaly is going to be. Oh, how big is the anomaly going to be? Oh, we don't know if it's there. You know, this is the kind of thing that you have. You have a total non-understanding of what exploration is about. And you have to go through the hoops of the archaeological check out, and before you've got a license, you've spent close to R1 million, and that just kills the Afrikaans word, the sniffler, you know, the guy, the prospector. So they've successfully killed, but the mining. I mean, we have an excellent relationship technically with the DMR in Rustenburg. from the actual things we do, the visits we get from them, from that point of view, we don't have a problem. But the problem is when the licensing and things like that, that is the bigger problem. And then you get to the environmental. The environmental is a nightmare. If you spring a leak in a pipe over here, it's an incident. How big must it be before it's an incident? And then you've got 24 hours in which to report it. If you don't report it, it's an offense. And it's absolutely crazy.
Okay, enough said. Anyway, fantastic. Ken Hone, have you got any comments as a mining engineer? We've got to sort of get some of you guys into the discussion as well.
Sorry, John, can you hear me there? I don't know how to use these things, it was before my time, this Zoom stuff.
We can hear you, that's all that counts.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Hi, Jim. That was a very good presentation, Jim. Very impressed, and having had a little to do with Fisher Mines at both Bourbillon and at Klipspringer, it just is really a difficult business. I don't know why you choose to stay in that business. It's a really tough ask. But Jim, thank you very much for an excellent presentation, and I think you're making some great strides forward there using some mechanized mining to get those fishes out. John, I just aside with Jim there in what he says, that the whole control thing is to make sure that you don't get the waste. Once you start getting the dilution, it just pushes your costs up, whether it's the hoisting of the material, whether it's the crushing, the sorting, and the recovery. And I think that what you're doing there, Jim, if your fishes allow it, I think you're going to be able to get a better control on your waste dilution. Other than that, you certainly highlighted all the issues on fisher mining. Thank you very much.
Great stuff. Thanks.
Ken,
thanks, Ken.
Thank you.
From Mike Shaw. Oh, you want to first say something, Jim?
No, I just want to say thank you to Ken. Nice to hear from him again. As I said in the beginning, curveballs are thrown at you, and you either handle them or you let them get you down. And as I said, if you're underground, you're underground, whether you one level or 20 level. The only difference there is you have to hoist the ore further and you have to pump your water further. Those are the only two things that are different. The rest is the same. You can handle stress levels by speaking to the geotechnical guys, and you set up your spacings. Everything else remains the same. It's just the people that manage it, the people that don't manage it, etc., that pull you down.
Right. Thanks,
Jim. Thanks again.
Mike Shaw and I myself have a question on the sorting. I was just thinking with you switching to waste picking, reef picking, is there a secondary cycle? And then leading on from that, Jim wants to know, do you see any potential for optical sorting of waste instead of hand sorting?
Okay, right, let's take the two things about optical and what happens in the mill, is that right? And your sizing. What we've done is at Helium, we're one of the few people few companies that have a kimberlite research license. I can do whatever I want to with it. And so we've got a little lab size mill, and between Jan and myself, Jan has been tremendous in helping me do all this stuff. We've done different iterations, and we find out that if we have we're going to put up a 2.7 meter AG mill. It's basically a glorified scrubber, but it's 2.7 meters, and it'll work as an AG mill. We will be able in first pass to get a 72%. Attrition of the kimberlite. So we then also look at what goes to -6. -6 is your discard size. And you land up with the zone between 6 and 16 millimeters. Now, helium, my feed size to the DMS will be 16, because in my life at helium, which is many years, we have never had a gem bigger than 15 carats. And 15 carats is a 12 millimeter stone. So I might take that 16 millimeter down to 13. And so we take 13 to six, to minus 6, goes to the DMS and gets sent away. And in that, we're sending away about 1.7% fissure, I think it was, 1.7% fissure. And it's 1.7% of fine stuff. Ladies don't like micro diamonds. So let them, that is the poor part of your thing. So you send it away. So what we're then doing is we are sending the plus 50 after it's been through the mill. We're sending the plus 50 to the crusher, and then we're feeding it back into the mill again. And that plus 50% is, I think, is something like about 5% of the fissure feed. So you will do a reef pick as opposed to doing waste picking. You'll do a reef pick. That reef pick, we've worked it down to, we will need a piece of kimberlite off the belt every 1.5 seconds. That is, you have two people doing that. So that's one piece of fissure every 3 seconds. That means that you have one rotational guy and you man the picker belt with three people, as opposed to having 16 waste pickers.
Now, what about the optical?
Optical, don't even try it. This, you give a guy's an optical sorter and they cost now about, I think, 10 million. This is what you call the NIR, the near infrared optical sorters. They cost you about 10 million rand nowadays, and it'll cost you the peripherals to do it, and the labor will cost you about another 10. So it'll cost you 20 million to put one in, and you will find pretty soon that the guys don't maintain it properly, and there's a lot of wet material that goes through the machine, so there's a lot of air blast going on, a lot of wet material. The eyes get fogged up very quickly, so you have to have a very fancy method of cleaning the eyes every now and then, before you know it, you come and visit the mine, you'll find that machine is not operating and the guys are doing something else. But in a nutshell, you will get, it'll cost you 20 million rand, and then you only got a certain size range that you can do, and you will get a loss of 10 to 15% of your fissure will be lost together with the waste in the blast. So you need a rougher and a scavenger. That'll cost you another 20 million. So if you want to put in waste sorters, 20 million bucks, and you'll be able to get your prime, but it's difficult. And it's just not to have a picker belt with a couple of people on instead of waste picking, reef picking, no, it wins hands down.
Okay. Now he closes out his question by saying technology is maturing quite quickly, so you don't have to rely on the hyperspectral. You can go to the visual spectrum as well. So maybe the machines are new now. One doesn't know.
Yeah, I think the key thing there, and that's what Jim has said. They need tender loving care. You know, those black boxes are fantastic, but then you need special clean environments and technicians and to actually keep them working. And you need a simple production line.
Yeah.
Any other questions, Adrian? You awake there?
Yeah, absolutely, John. One question, Jim, actually. That 3D image you showed of the Hope Diamond, the different ore bodies there, the Veenensfontein was the deepest one. It looked like there was the most mining carried out there. Is there an extension along strike further down of that Veenensfontein fissure with an offset?
Yes, it carries on. It carries on eastward. It carries on. You 1 or 2 kilometers east of that, you've got the Driekop. I think it's the Driekop. There's a blow and fishers, and but all lower grades.
Okay. Just look like an exploration target.
Stuart has another question for you, Jim. Stuart?
Hi, Jim. I'm trying to...
Lost you.
Stuart, we can't hear you. We're not hearing you.
You've got your visual...
Okay, not... right. Can you hear me now? I've got it. I'm also a novice for this. The... again, with technology, but probably prohibitively expensive at this stage, is instead of crushing where you can damage your diamonds, even though you know your maximum size, there's this technology, CellFrag, which you might have heard of. University of Pretoria has a unit, and what it does is it fires a very high voltage electric pulse into water where you're ore pieces of ore are, primary crushed pieces of ore. And it disaggregates it along grain boundaries. So any diamond in the piece of ore would come out totally intact.
Okay, Stuart, can I reply on that? I'm aware of the technology. But the unfortunate thing about that, one is to a large extent it's untried. Secondly, it's going to cost a huge amount of money to do that. And then thirdly, now in diamonds, I don't have type 2 diamonds here, so I don't have to worry about big ones and things like that. I have this philosophy that if a diamond can be crushed, it should be crushed. Because you want gems, you don't want the rubbish. And it's mostly the rubbish that it has cracks and things like that. Gem diamonds don't get broken in the crushing process. So further with that, I've gone to AG milling, where we got comminution by milling. So we're getting rid of the crushers.